So my name's Jason Kururangi. I work for a firm called Milford Asset Management, which is named after the iconic Milford Sound in New Zealand. If we take a step back, we think the next decade is one where particularly Australian equity markets can perform really well in a global context. Now, why do we say a decade for Australia? If we look at the ASX, actually in many time horizons, it performs quite differently to some other global markets. And what drives that? Certainly a big part of that is the composition of the benchmark and the companies within the Australian market. So if we take a step back, what is Australia good at? Mining, oil and gas, financials. Those are some of the big index positions or big parts of the market in Australia. We think that we're going into a period where a number of those companies or industries become increasingly important moving forward. When we look at it, we think about three main themes driving that change: decarbonisation, deglobalisation, and shifts in demographics. We think we're going into a period of higher growth. Decarbonisation, why do we think this is important? The spend is going to be enormous. We're talking $3 trillion per annum potentially in reallocating and shifting electricity grids, renewable energy, autos, auto manufacturing, all of these good things. There's a lot of money that needs to be spent and deployed into renewable energy. That's going to require a lot of resources, so natural resources that go into make up wind turbines, iron ore, steel, oil, gas needs to be used to actually extract some of these resources. And we also have lithium batteries. One of the stocks we think is a huge beneficiary of this is Independence Group. They're a clean energy metals miner who's transitioned well ahead of a lot of their peers to be positioned in lithium and nickel and some minor positions in copper as well. They're fully funded and they're one of the lowest cost, or they are the lowest cost lithium producer globally. So they're well positioned to go through the next decade as we have huge investment into lithium and into a changing, decarbonised electricity network. So we're very positive on IGO and think it's a great story. Deglobalisation, we're living in a completely different climate. We've got geopolitical divides globally. There's a growing importance on self-dependency, resiliency. We think that drives another investment boom for Western countries. And we're already starting to see that in the US with the Inflation Reduction Act. You've seen chip manufacturing being tried to transition back to the US. There's a tech war going on, or a subtle tech war going on between China, the US for tech supremacy. We've got Russia invading Ukraine, which has a number of other implications around global energy markets, resource markets. But there is this overarching drive for self-sufficiency, self-dependency, and frankly, some militarisation. Goodman Group, as another classic Australian company, globally one of the best developers, owners, and managers of industrial real estate. Industrial real estate's been, I guess, a hot commodity for at least the last 10 years, but particularly through that COVID period where we saw very low levels of vacancy globally and huge investment going into the space. So through that period, Goodman did very well. We're in a period of adjustment at the moment as people are a little bit worried about asset values in commercial real estate. Goodman are very well positioned. Their balance sheet is exceptionally clean. There's not a lot of debt on it, and they have a number of growth drivers to keep developing out their portfolio globally. You've got probably the best-in-class management team globally looking after the business as well. And they're very well aligned with shareholders. A lot of long-term incentives for management that drive value long-term with the company. So we really like Goodman Group as a de-globalisation story, and we think that they'll be massive beneficiaries of that moving forward. We're talking about demographics. For us, We have been through a supernormal period of growth through the, the baby boomers coming through and kind of population growth through that period. And we're coming to the end of that growth, and our whole population and the demographics around it are shifting. We think one of the things that may happen is actually we're going to have a shrinking workforce, and that's going to drive higher wages and higher inflation. So if we think about what's happened through the COVID period and post, and what's driven a lot of the excess inflation, or what's really kept the central banks worried and why they're tightening rates, it's the labour market. They're worried about embedding inflation into expectations, and therefore costs continuing to rise and then having no control over it and not an economy level. And when CPI goes into people's contracts and you get this embedded inflation, you can end up with a cost spiral in your economy, and you can't kind of control that. It disproportionately hits people at lower incomes rather than higher incomes, and you can have political challenges. One of the stocks we think indirectly benefits from this is CSL. Now, CSL are, again, a global leader, very, very impressive business. We think they will benefit from this demographic shift, given the makeup of the products that they sell. They have a fantastic flu business, which they bought off Novartis about 5 or 6 years ago and integrated with their own company, their own flu vaccine business. They also benefit through things like chronic kidney disease. So as you get an older population, you get more people with some of the issues around kidney failure and heart failure, then you are likely to see them benefit from that as well. They have been depressed in terms of plasma volumes and collection ability through that COVID period, and just despite the share price fairly flat through that period, there was a lot of volatility through their earnings for what's usually a very stable company and expectations. We think we're about to go through a new cycle for CSL, where we're going to see significant volume growth on the back of additional collection centres they rolled out through COVID and prior to that. So they're going to pick up more plasma. So we are very positive on CSL, and we think it's going to be a structural winner through this period as well. Call it 25% of the ASX's might be mining companies. There's a 30% of its financials, industrials, and then energy. If we think about all of the beneficiaries of increased capex, changing supply chains, shifting demographics, they really benefit those natural resource companies, miners, potentially oil and gas. If we just take a step back and think about what's going to drive the earnings growth of the market, that mining sector is a huge part of what makes us positive on the Australian economy moving forward. We've gone through a period, we've seen China reopening, US inflation moderation, and sort of a change in a narrative to maybe a pivot. We've seen significant liquidity injected into the system since October, and we've seen positioning shift in the market. So we remain cautious, and in our positioning, we actually have elevated cash at the moment, but we are looking to redeploy once we get some of the risks around a US debt ceiling resolved, once we get through the sort of central bank changes in rhetoric through this period and what happens around China and their reopening. Hopefully that was short and sharp and to the point.